Jarvis, the name may be familiar, was born to Granville E. Jarvis and Anne Jarvis on May 1st, 1864, in Webster, West Virginia. Now, her mother, remember the name? Anne, with whom she shared almost the same first name, Anna and Anne, died almost the same day in May. She died on May 10th, 1905, exactly, in Virginia. And after grieving 3 years later to the day, Anna Jarvis held a memorial ceremony to honor her reposed mother and all mothers at the Church of St. Andrews in Grafton, West Virginia, which was the first official celebration of Mother's Day. Now, this interesting lady spent her whole life, it seems, trying then to make that event, that day, that dedication as official and recognized and widespread as she could, and as we can see, she had great success. Although two things. One, she became very distressed at the commercial takeover of the day she had imagined as a different kind of day. And secondly, she herself never married and never had children and never became a mother. And so Mother's Day is about remembering our mother in particular, including if she has passed away, including in liturgical prayers. And yes, all mothers in general. And that is very biblical and Christian, is it not? Although, I'm going to jump off my script and share a few thoughts that are not here. Though, I think we can share the distress that this holiday, this secular holiday, became commercialized, and for Christians, if it means not coming to church but going elsewhere, is a problem. And why is that? Because for us Christians, our mother is no longer truly our biological mother, let's face it. There is this current of honoring your biological parents in the scriptures, but there's also a current where our true brother and sisters are in the church, our true father is in heaven, and our true mother is the church. So on Mother's Day, we should primarily honor the church. This being said, I continue. It is very biblical and Christian to honor your parents, and especially your mother. Now, Christianity was defined by the foremost spokesperson of this faith after Jesus, and that I think would be James, the Lord's brother of Jerusalem, the first bishop, who said that Christianity, true religion, is to take care of orphans and widows. Because orphans have no mothers, and widows are mothers that have lost their support. So it's very biblical. And I think we can imagine how life-changing and world-changing it would be if we could be part of restoring the honor and respect and support due to mothers in our world. Then we could have an impact for generations. We could have an impact here and throughout the world by restoring the honor to motherhood and supporting those who are mothers. So where do we start in the Bible? How about a very unusual, for me, unexpected place? I looked at verses, and this one I did not expect to see. It's in Romans 16, 13, so at the end of Romans, when St. Paul sends greetings to people he knows in Rome. And he says this, "Greet Rufus," that's his name, "chosen in the Lord, and also his mother." who has been a mother to me as well. Mm-hmm. How interesting. Mother is much more than biology. An adoptive mother can be as much a mother, maybe more sometimes, than a biological mother. A spiritual mother can be as much a mother or more than a natural mother. And so I can almost agree with Oprah today when she said, it's very rare, when she says, biology is the least of what makes someone a mother. It's almost true, of course, because biology is a very strong part of it. But in the ultimate sense, you know, the ultimate bonds, the ultimate reality is spiritual. Mother is as mother acts and as mother loves. What does it mean to be mother then? It means my heart yearns for my child, as we will see. It means having a love that is beyond understanding, even sometimes beyond reason. A heart that only wants the very best, no matter what, no matter the sacrifice, no matter the pain. And a completely unexpected, again, to me, encounter with what it means to be a mother, I found in a well-known story, but we never really think of it that way. It's in 1 Kings. It's the story which everybody knows, I hope, even out there, when these two mothers are fighting legally in front of King Solomon the Wise over a baby, claiming that this living baby is their baby. And listen to what the scriptures have. Then the king said, the one says, this is my son that is alive, and your son is dead. And the other one says, no, your son is dead, but my son is a living one. So the king said, bring me a sword. So a sword was brought before the king, and the king said, divide, cut the living child in two, and give half to the one and half to the other. Then the woman whose son was alive said to the king, because her heart yearned for her son, oh my lord, give her the living child, and by no means put him to death. But the other said, he shall be neither mine nor yours. Divide him. Then the king said, give the living child to the first woman, and by no means put him to death. She is his mother. What a powerful verse. Since we are with King Solomon, let's think about what it meant for him, who was, at least at first, a new Adam, a new priest king, a new glorious human being filled with wisdom, an icon of Christ. So in 1 Kings, there is a scene where you see how the king treated his mother, and so should we. It says, so Bathsheba, that's his mother. Not perfect, as we know. So Bathsheba went to see her son, King Solomon, to speak to him on behalf of Adonijah. One, the king rose to meet her. Two, he bowed down to her. Three, sat on his throne. Four, at a throne brought for the king's mother, and she sat on his right. And then he said, and then she said, I have one small request to make of you, do not refuse me. And the king said, make your request, my mother, for I will not refuse you. That's how we treat our mother. That's the way the Lord treats his mother. And in fact, in Israel, the queen wasn't, as I've told before, the wife of the king, who may have had many short-lived wives. The queen was the mother of the king, called the Gebirah. I'll give you one verse, Jeremiah 13:18, where the Lord speaks to Jeremiah, and the Lord says, say to the king and the queen mother, the Gebirah, take a lowly seat, for your beautiful crown has come down from your head. How many crowns? One, for the king and his mother. Now, what does this have to do with the gospel? Well, we could say, you know, today we remember St. John the Evangelist, and the Lord, in his dying breath, said, "Behold your mother, behold your son." He entrusted his mother to his beloved disciple. But more than that, motherhood, I believe, womanhood, and for us men, our respect for it, is at the core of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's part of what we proclaim, the light we shine in the world, the hope, the joy, the beauty, the healing we proclaim. We start with Eve, of course. Eve means mother of the living. Mother of the living. And the conflict, lest we forget, isn't that much between Adam and the serpent. It is between the serpent and the woman Eve. What we call the proto-gospel, the first great prophecy, the first great news proclaimed, Genesis 3:15, which we should know by heart. I will put enmity, fight, struggle, hatred, war, between you, the serpent, and the woman, and between your offspring and hers, and he will strike your head. He, the offspring of the woman, will strike your head. That's the good news. Someone will come from the woman who will put an end to this enmity, and you will strike his heel. So the good news, the gospel, is about triumphant, fulfilled, divine motherhood. And I have to say, also, who hears the gospel for the first time? Is it not Mary? When the angel comes from the throne to say, "Don't be afraid, for you have found favor with God," that's the good news. "You will conceive in your womb and bear a son," that's good news for a Jewish woman. "And you will name him Jesus," which means Savior. "He will be great. He will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will have no end." She is the first one to hear the good news about Jesus. But then she's also the first one to proclaim, to embody the good news. When a few weeks later, she goes to see Elizabeth, and I will not read the entire scene in Luke chapter 1, but the good news is so good that even in the womb, it is experienced. John the Baptist leaps of joy. And we have this entire dialogue between Elizabeth and Mary about Mary, the mother, receiving and giving the gospel as we should. Jesus was a Jewish boy. Sometimes I guess I made a movie recently about young Messiah, but sometimes we just don't really think that much about the fact that when the Lord says, "You know, whoever has clothed me and fed me and taken care of me and visited me," she, Mary, did this night after night, week after week, year after year, longer than anybody I know. How much does the king owe his mother of his wisdom, of his knowledge for the scriptures? We know that Joseph was out there carpentering, right? There were no public schools that I'm aware of. And so Jesus, like every Jewish prince and firstborn, received wisdom from his mother. And so I think today we can enter into this mystery of motherhood, the mother that truly triumphed. And I would say that Mother's Day is a great day to delve deep into the beauty and glory of the gospel. Because the true gospel, which we proclaim, really it affirms life. It honors motherhood. It does everything it can to protect them, to support them. And I think in reverse, the true gospel cuts through the darkness because a war still exists in the world against women. There's so much lying, so much violence, so much abuse, so much enslavement. There's still a war of indecency and pornography and lying and deceit. And the gospel shines in the darkness and brings peace and beauty and true honor to all mothers. And so our task is simple. It is to embrace the fullness of the beauty and depth, the convincing power of the gospel of Christ, the great King Solomon, born of this unique mother, who mystically, you know, is mother, daughter, and bride, mystically. And for us, that true mother is the church. It's the church. St. Cyprian said, no one can say that he has God as his father if he does not have the church as his mother. On this day, we honor the Holy Church. We honor all mothers. We honor our God. And Savior Jesus Christ was given us the gospel to proclaim and to share and to live now and forever unto the ages of ages. Amen. Christ is risen. Indeed, he is risen.